When was the last time somebody poked you in the ribs? For me, Kurt Weill's music is like a friendly jab. It's the 100th anniversary of Weill's birth this month, so we're going to have a little jolt of his music today on A Note to You. I'm Virginia Eskin. Kurt Weill is going to be the subject of the program today, and later on, we'll invite into the studio Paulina Stark. She's head of the voice faculty at UMass, and we've collaborated together. In fact, she was a guest on our George Sand Salon program a little while back. But we're going to go back to Kurt Weill's beginning, because I have found it very interesting. I always was aware of the cabaret music, and I think that you'll find his early music equally interesting and extremely unusual. He grew up in the Baden area of southwest Germany. His father was the cantor at the local synagogue in Dessau. So the family arranges for him to study music, and it even says that he was so talented that he was given art lessons when he's in high school as a teenager. So he's manifesting all kinds of talents, and that's going to stand him in good stead later on when he's involved in the theater. And he seems to have gone to all the right schools. His father arranges for him to study with all the right teachers, including Engelbert Humperdinck, and eventually the pianist and composer Ferruccio Busoni. I noticed that he's not going to temple in those years. So if he's born in 1900, when he's 15 and 16, he's not turning his back on going the same route, say, that of his father, becoming a cantor, but he's grabbing at all the opportunities that any bright young composer would. And he becomes one of Busoni's students. He moves to Berlin when he's about 16, and that has an enormous impact on his life, because Busoni was a very fine pianist and encourages him to compose kind of more romantic sounding music, because the great lions of the day would be Schoenberg and Alban Berg. And sometimes Weill's music sounds to me like Berg, and even Bartok. And when you listen to this portion we're going to play now of his first symphony, which is composed in 1921, if you wanted to play a trick on me, I would swear it had been written by Bartok, because it has those very odd intervals. They're tenths, and that was a echt sort of German Viennese thing to do. And also the whole orchestration is very much tighter. It's smaller. They are writing not for full symphony orchestra. They're getting away from Schumann and Mendelssohn and all the romantic composers. They want to establish their own voice. And the first thing you do is write for a different ensemble. You change the orchestration. You write in dark keys. And it all combines to have this very strange, haunting sort of quality, which all those composers in Czechoslovakia, Germany, Austria, they're all painted with this very, very interesting brush. So let's move to hear just a little portion of his first symphony, because that's right in the beginning, and then we'll go backwards a little bit. Here's Kurt Weill's Symphony No. 1.
Thank you.
That was a portion of Kurt Weill's Symphony No. 1, composed in 1921. It was played by the New Philharmonia Orchestra with Frederick Prausnitz conducting. And boy, you have to admire starting your first symphony in life with huge chords. Sort of unusual thing to do. And then all of that strange harmony twisting around, it really does seduce you. And we're going to listen to a little bit of his string quartet now, which was composed 2 years later. We're going to just listen to the scherzo movement. It's the second movement. It's Opus 8. And according to our sources, it's unpublished. So this Brandis quartet that plays it must have had some difficulty in getting the music. Listen to how, when he's trying to be witty and gay, this is Kurt Weill's version of that. Thank you. That was just the scherzo movement from Kurt Weill's String Quartet, Opus 8, played by the Brandes Quartet. I found myself sort of thinking it sort of reminded one of the little nursery ditty, you know, why don't you come out to play? But it sort of putrefies, and it's not, it's merry and light, as a scherzo movement should be, but it's got that haunting Austrian-German quality. And if you look at the work of Kurt Schwitters or maybe Paul Klee, the composition is very tight, it's minimalistic, and that's in Kurt Weill's music. The music he's writing at this time in his life is very much like that. He sticks with maybe three colors or three kinds of harmonic colors. He's eventually going to spread his palette, but all this early music that I didn't even know existed. Now we're going to hear a little bit of the Violin Concerto, and it continues somewhat in the same vein. It's composed a year later in 1924, and I feel the foundation for his mature style is going to be laid now, beginning in year 24, and it's more expressive than the music we've heard up until now. Here's the nocturne movement from his Violin Concerto. That was the Nocturne movement from Kurt Weill's Violin Concerto, which is Opus 12. It's about 1924 when he's written that. And did you hear how he's now developing a melody line in the music? He's going to allow himself that. And in the year 27, he meets up with Bertolt Brecht in Berlin, and they start an incredible, fruitful collaboration, which stands them all their lives. Brecht eventually comes over to America once Weill moves here. And their ballet, The Seven Deadly Sins, gets produced in Paris. The year is 1933, and the choreography was by George Balanchine and another man who's eventually going to move to America, Maurice Abravanel, is the conductor. And all that one reads about this time, it just seems so incredibly rich and interesting. And even though it was tumultuous politically, it would have been a very interesting time to be a musician and to be a composer. And it sounds like they made the best of a situation that was starting to crumble. And Weill and Brecht both leave Germany and move up to Paris. And they realize that things were unraveling. And there's an incident when stormtroopers broke in and stopped one of their productions in a cabaret in about 33. So the writing's on the wall. The idea, if you can, you better leave. And the Jews who were into denial paid a horrible price. And Weill was able to leave. I think he had a sense of his own musical worth, and it's considerable. And the commentary that goes with the Seven Deadly Sins, of course, is on all the horrible sins, lust, pride, greed, avarice. We're going to hear just one of the deadly sins. We think only one will do it. And I like the sound of pride better than sloth or avarice, greed, lust. And it's going to be sung by Anja Silja with the Cleveland Orchestra conducted by Noknani.
Als wir aber ausgestattet waren, Wäsche hatten, Kleider und Hüte, fanden wir auch bald eine Stelle in einem Kabarett als Tänzerin, und zwar in Memphis, der zweiten Stadt. Thank you.
Was Pride by Kurt Weill from The Seven Deadly Sins, sung by Anja Silja, with the Cleveland Orchestra and Doknanyi conducting. At this time, in about 1933, he's already married the actress Lottie Lenya. That had happened back in 1926, and she eventually becomes the main singer in most of Kurt Weill's productions. And they had met, and it's a very cute story. He was collaborating with Georg Kaiser on a libretto, and Kaiser lived on a sort of on a lake, and there were two ways to get to his villa. Once you had taken the train to the little town, you could be picked up by a buggy or a car, or you could be fetched by rowboat. And Kaiser said, "Why don't you hop in the boat and go pick up Kurt?" And she said, "All right." Apparently, Lottie Lenya was a good rower, so she took the little rowboat and she rows over across the lake because that was the quick way. And there he is, standing in a suit. And he's all very formal looking, which was odd for a day in the country. But all the descriptions of him sound like he was always very nicely attired in very good suits. And he may have been 5 feet tall and had to wear thick glasses and didn't have much hair, but he made up for it with those piercing eyes. And he has a wonderful manner, and he was very friendly. And over, you're struck by what a good colleague he was and what a good friend. And he falls head over heels in love. Of course, she has great legs, and you can imagine. She says, "Come on, get into the boat." And what is he to do? It wasn't exactly what he had in mind. And from that moment on, they really fall heavily for each other. And their relationship goes up and down, though. You can read in between the lines. They even divorce and remarry, and he goes off with a couple of other kind of glamorous women. But I think World War II cemented their relationship because everybody was so afraid. And she invents a way of putting across his music because her voice is kind of marginal, but she has this fantastic cabaret style, and that has such an appeal for him. So there's another instance of him meeting somebody who's going to be very crucial to his artistic output. When I was just listening to the song we heard from The Seven Deadly Sins, I was struck again by what happens now in all of Weill's music. It's not that he's ambivalent, but he'll be in a major key, and then he changes it. And what that does is pulls the rug out underneath the music, first of all, because the harmonic structure changes. But he does it over and over and over to great effect. And in all the popular songs, you'll be in one key. So he's playing with our ears. It's major, it's minor, it's a little augmented, it's a little diminished, it's a little demented, it's all sorts of things. You don't really know where you stand. So it's quite a challenge for the musician or the singer to knit it together. And that throws it back on the text, and the words have such impact. He moves further and further away from all the music that we've been hearing, which is intellectual music, and it would come from the great German tradition, really, of the 19th century. He's a creature of the 20th century. So he creates the role of Jenny in Threepenny Opera, really for Lottie Lenya, and it was first produced back in Germany, back in 28, and it got him into a lot of trouble. That opera is based on the early one that comes really from 200 years before that by John Gay, the famous English composer, and it's a remake of the Beggar's Opera put in Germany, and it gets staged in Germany, and then eventually it's staged in America, even before he arrives here. So he has some presence. And we're going to hear the canon song for orchestra, and then right after that, you'll hear Lottie Lenya singing the famous ballad of Mac the Knife. This is music by Kurt Weill. Feel like you're really in a cabaret in Germany. That was the canon song for orchestra played by the Ensemble Modern, and then Lottie Lenya singing the Ballad of Mac the Knife with an orchestra conducted by Roger Bean. By now, Kurt Weill is a committed musical theater composer, and he doesn't really write symphonies or chamber orchestras or violin pieces. or even piano pieces. He's really committed to the musical theater voice, cabaret in particular. And coming up after the ID, we're going to bring Paulina Stark on board, and we're going to talk about all the cabaret music, songs, and which was really the way his life turned. I'm Virginia Eskin, and today, on A Note to You, we're listening to the music of Kurt Weill. He was born 100 years ago this month. If you have something to say about our program, please drop me a line. I promise I'll write back. The address is A Note to You, care of WGBH Radio, 125 Western Avenue, Boston, Massachusetts, 02134. The email address is anotetoyou@wgbh.org. A Note to You is made possible by the friends and alumni of Northeastern University. Kurt Weill was busy making a living because now he's got Lottie Lena as his wife. And apparently they made out all right because there's mention of a home being bought when they were back, just moving up to Paris. He's made enough money, even after the crash, to buy a lovely country home. And they speak of it being decorated with simple furniture. And it was near a mill. Alas, they're only going to get to use it sporadically for about 2 years, and then it has to be sold because they're going to emigrate to America. Back when he was studying with Busoni, he, to support himself then, played as a beer keller, which means beer hall pianist, in a cabaret. And he never liked the term cabaret, Paulina has told me. He liked the word art song. And we're going to listen to two sort of interesting examples of that period. We're getting him emigrated sort of slowly. The first is going to be called Berlin Lit Up, and that was a thing that was curiously put together. It was sort of like a Sony Lumiere production. They literally lit up Berlin, and we want you to hear, it's got that crazy rhythm, that sort of, which is cabaret rhythm. Whenever you want to take any song, you could take Ave Maria, God forbid, and cabaretize it. It's sacrilege to do that. But the minute you put that kind of moving rhythm underneath the melody, we know immediately you're supposed to be in your fishnet stockings, you've got your whip out, and you've got your phone ready to call somebody over across the room. So here's Berlin Lit Up by Kurt Weill.
Licht, damit man sehen kann, ob was da ist. Komm, mach mal Licht und rede nun mal nicht. Komm, mach mal Licht, dann wollen wir doch auch mal sehen, ob das ne Sache ist, Berlin im Licht.
That was Berlin Let Up with H.K. Gruber conducting the Ensemble Moderne. And we're going to go now to about 1934. And my guest, Paulina Stark, is here and she's going to sing for us too. She's head of the voice faculty at University of Massachusetts in Amherst. And she's a Kurt Weill specialist. You've sung a lot of cabaret, Paulina.
I'm a big fan of Kurt Weill, that's for sure.
Not easy music to understand, because you and I were remarking it's just so tinged with this bittersweet quality, because we know what happened in Germany in the Holocaust, and I can't hear it without sort of thinking of that.
You know, I have the same reaction, Virginia, because even listening to what you just played, I thought, what is this sort of a sickeningly sweet, kind of innocent-sounding music doing, knowing what was happening politically. And I think that's why all the music, this cabaret era, is so fascinating.
Well, let's sing a beautiful song that you and I have worked on before from his Paris days, from the big opera he wrote, or not, would you say operetta? Is Marie Galante a...
It's another musical play, just as he did, another wonderful theater piece. He was invited to France because his friends there, like Millot and others, knew that he was in trouble and needed a place to go, and they arranged that he have a publisher who was the light music division of the Heugel company. And this piece that we're going to do now, J'attends un navire, from Marie Galante, just proves what kind of musical chameleon Kurt Weill was. This is in French, and is so French in its style that it became one of the favorite songs of the French Résistance.
What does it translate to?
She says, I'm waiting for a ship that will come. And in order to carry this ship or to guide it along, the ship will have the wind from my heart, which is sighing, the water from my tears, which will carry it, and if the ocean wants to destroy it, then I will carry it all by myself, all the way to Bordeaux, in my own arms. That means she's going to get it.
Well, here we are. Paulina Stark is singing, and I'm accompanying her.
A beautiful girl, bella francesa, $2, tu seras content. Entre chez moi, mets-toi à l'aise, prends-moi, paye-moi, et va-t'en. Par ce n'est pas toi que j'attends un navire qui viendra et pour le conduire. Ce navire a le vent de mon cœur qui soupire, l'eau de mes plaies.
l'erle portera. E si la mervelle ritrire, sanno vire, chi viadrà, je porterai ce navire, jusqu'à bordo, entre mes bras, là-bas on m'appelait Marie.
Paulina Stark singing a wonderful Kurt Weill song, I'm Waiting for Navire. She's waiting for her ship to come in. And as Paulina explained before, if the ship doesn't come in, she's going to personally drag it with her tears and a few other things.
Well, she's pretty desperate. She wants to get home, and she's in a typical kind of decadent and weird plot. This is a girl who has been tricked into going to Panama, and she ends up as a prostitute, and she wants to go home. So she's ready to carry the ship herself.
Now, speaking of Panama, we want to insert here, Paulina, just a little bit of an orchestral suite from this opera, Marie Galante. We're just going to have the opening portion from the Panamanian suite. Here it is.
Thank you.
So that was a good example of the kind of French sound that Kurt Weill was cultivating when he lived in Paris. And that was from his Marie Galante operetta, and that was played by the Ensemble Moderne, the same group we heard just a little bit ago with Berlin Lit Up, H.K. Gruber conducting. And Weill and Lainia leave France. They move to New York in 1935. And if we thought it was a fecund and interesting time to be living in Germany back in the 20s and early 30s, New York is an even headier time. And he, of course, good colleague that he is, he's introduced to all the major players who were working on Broadway. So now Paulina and I are going to do another song, and this is from Kurt Weill's Johnny Johnson. You don't call it an opera.
It's, you know, that's the in German they call them Singspiel or what that sort of thing. I call them musicals in the same sense that we have a Stephen Sondheim musical that has operatic characteristics and goes from spoken to half sung to really requiring the operatic voice.
Well, and of course Schoenberg did it in Sprechstimme. It's got a very Altdeutsch sort of chic to it when it's done, or in Berg's Lulu opera, it goes back and forth. But what we're talking about, and you and I were saying that it goes back to Mozart's time where people would talk or sing. But this is all jammed together. You're speaking and singing even within one bar.
Right. This goes in Kurt Weill's own words. He wants it to go everywhere, every combination of singing and speech, from the level of pure speech to the level of pure singing and everything in between. But always, he says, the voice, it must come in and out of the music, and the words dictate what you do.
All right. Well, here's a good example of what we were talking about before, too, major and minor. This is Mon Ami, my friend. It's the girl singing about the few hours she's going to spend with a sailor boy.
This is the French nurse, and she, I assume, has a French accent. The lyrics are by Paul Green, one of the many fabulous script writers and collaborators that Kurt Weill had during his career, one after another.
And sing to cheer the weary soldier at his homecoming. A little room together, an hour of love to spend. Come, sew your arm around me, oh, mon ami, my friend. But she remembers that other love and joy, the first, the best, the dearest tired soldier boy. A narrow room alone then, rain on the roof above, and he will sleep forever. Oh, mon ami, my love. Does not sit and grieve, but sings away her sorrow to cheer the soldiers leave. For life is short and funny, and love must have an end. An hour may be forever, oh, mon ami, my friend. For life is short and funny, and love must have an end. An hour may be forever, oh, mon ami, my friend.
Paulina Stark singing, and I was playing for her, and that was Mon Ami, my friend, from Johnny Johnson. Well, we're going to go out. Our final piece on our Kurt Weill program, this is going to be Prelude, Moonface Starry-Eyed, and then you'll hear Blues, a song, I Got a Marble and a Star, and it's from Kurt Weill's Broadway production, Street Scene. ¶¶
First thing in the morning, Miss Jones.
Says you.
I got a halo and a hat, but my halo I don't wear. Got a halo and a hat, my halo I don't wear. I'm gonna save that halo.
That was Creighton Thompson singing, backed up by the Columbia Orchestra. Marisa Bravanel was conducting, and it was a little excerpt from Street Scene. And our subject today has been Kurt Weill, and we have barely put our toe in the water. Thanks to my guest, Paulina Stark.
It was fun, as always, to make music here.
Maybe we should go to work together in cabarets and support our husbands.
There you go.
Our thanks today to engineer Alan Mattis. Our producer is Alan McClellan, and I'm Virginia Eskin. A Note to You is made possible by the friends and alumni of Northeastern University. It's produced by Northeastern University in cooperation with WGBH Radio, Boston.